You found a place to belong here in the Circle of Friends. I'm Missy, and I'm here with Gwen, and we are just having a good chat this week, are we not?
We are. You know, anytime we talk about salvation and what God did when he sent his son, it's always a good day.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as believers need to preach, in the words of Jerry Bridges, we need to preach the gospel to ourselves every day.
Every day.
We need to preach the cross of Christ to ourselves.
Every day. Because we know who we are without him and without that, you know, perspective and that vision before us, without his help, we can't even walk the Christian life. You know, some of my reading has been in Judges recently. Recently, I've been reading in Judges, and there's a lot in Judges that Gwen, I just have to say, I shake my head at, and I don't understand. I don't understand how people could have that perception or have that, or they could do what they did, or things that are really violent and don't make any sense. And you think, but these are the people of God. And then, you know, at the end of the chapter, and in many of the chapters of Judges, it says, in those days, there was no king in Israel. And here's the part that's a killer. Mm-hmm. Everyone did what was right in his own eyes. And I think that's what we live in a lot of times. And even in the fellowship of the body of Christ, rather than looking to the word of God, people are doing what's right in their own eyes. Mm-hmm. What they've heard, what somebody else told them, what they've gleaned, and what they put together is sometimes really convoluted.
Yeah.
Because, you know, so-and-so absolutely. Said this, and you pick up this here, and then somebody said that, and so you pick up this, and this sounds right, and you pick up that. And a lot of times you're picking up things from the world and the culture that, you know, maybe have a little bit of truth in. That's the way Satan works. He puts just a little bit of truth in mixed with the other stuff. So it sort of sounds good, sounds right, and you're drawn to the rest of the stuff.
Or you're picking up some of the twists from the Christian world.
Yeah.
Because not everything coming out of the Christian world lines up with Scripture completely. Well, if you're not in God's Word, you're not going to know what's got a warp to it and what doesn't.
Yep.
You know, just for example, please hear me, if I'm stepping on your toes with this, I'm doing this with a whole lot of love. But God's not a vending machine.
He's not a genie in a bottle.
And
he's,
you don't get this perfect, blessed, financially overflowing life when you follow him. And if somebody's selling you that, you need to find a different source for your spiritual growth. Because look at how much of the New Testament is suffering.
Yeah.
These believers were not thriving. Yeah. The following Christ was banishment from family, you know, losing families, losing.
And think beyond our own world. God absolutely blesses us and he wants to bless us. But the thinking that he's going to bless us materially is so narrow-minded. When you think of the world and our brothers and sisters in other countries who are literally fighting to meet together in assembly, who are persecuted in ways we can't even begin to imagine. And the truth is, Gwen, their faith in a lot of circumstances is so much bigger than ours.
Yeah.
Their walk with God is so much more amazing. Honestly, I think we in our culture could do with some persecution. Maybe that would help us get. And I'm not desiring that. I'm not saying that at all.
Persecution galvanizes the church.
Yes.
It streamlines it. One, it shifts out people who are not here for the right reasons, who do not have a faith anchored in truth. It shifts you because whenever all of a sudden, you know, let's take the health wealth type thinking, okay? If I believe that because I have enough faith, God will heal me, he'll bless me, you know, all of these things will happen, then what happens when cancer comes?
Yeah.
You know, if I'm not in God's word, I don't understand that, for example, cancer is one of the direct impacts of the sin's impact on our bodies and mankind and just everything in existence was impacted by that fall, by the fall, by sin. In entering, that from that point on, everything in creation was in a state of decay.
Mm-hmm.
And so to understand that things shifted, like all of a sudden there were weeds and all of a sudden animals ate hate each other. And, you know, all of a sudden you had all of these things shift in creation. And I don't think, you know, if you're not well-versed in scripture, you may not even realize that. Mm-hmm. You know, some of us who are, you know, even familiar with certain parts of the scripture may not be aware of how much creation shifted after the fall. In the fall, I'm talking about Genesis chapter 3, where Eve eats the apple off of the tree. Some of us are coming to Christ, but literally have had no biblical foundation or knowledge whatsoever. And so, you know, a lot of times we're listening and trying to find people who seem to know what they're doing. But the thing is, if we don't go back to God's word as our standard, we're never going to recognize who's right on and who's off. Mm-hmm. You know, we're just not going to know.
Yeah.
You know, and so when life hits and when, you know, we're facing a crisis in our faith or we're facing persecution at work because we wanted to pray and or somebody saw a Bible on our desk or, you know, just whatever, or we're getting hit with questions or people that expect us to act certain ways because we're Christian and so they're expecting us to hate them or reject them or, you know, call them a sinner, and they're putting us on the spot. We need to be ready and equipped to have an answer. Well, 2 Timothy chapter 3 tells us in verse 16 and 17 that scripture is inspired by God. It is profitable for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, for equipping believers. That it's God's word that literally equips us to be ready always to give an answer for the hope and the faith that we have. And so if you're not in God's word, you got nothing when life is got you in the dryer and your world's literally on the spin cycle in a washing machine, you know, or when a friend is questioning or somebody's antagonistically coming at you and attacking you. Mm-hmm. If you haven't done the work to equip yourself in God's word and become familiar with it enough on your own, you're going to be quoting somebody else instead of going, well, I can tell you what God's word says about that if you're interested.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think even for our own roots, if we don't put those roots down deep in scripture, then even living in our times, which, you know, in this world we're in now, the uncertainty, the craziness that seemed to happen overnight, but really didn't, and it didn't surprise God. Mm-hmm. But many people are living in fear, and so...
Yeah.
What do you yourself do with that? Because I understand the fear, the unknown, what could happen. But also, how do you live out your faith in such a way that it's stronger than the fear and it shows other people that they can live fearless lives as well? Yeah. Well, you can't do that without knowing scripture, without being grounded in the word to know and knowing that God is sovereign, right, that he has a plan, that he's going to work it all out. And really, this world is going to come to an end one day. Yes. I mean, when you read from Genesis to Revelation, you get that there's a plan and we're part of this story. We're on the continuum here. And God is going to, he will bring his kingdom and there will be a new heaven and a new earth. So the certainty of that, while that might scare some people, it really shouldn't. And if you know scripture, if you have a relationship with the Lord, that should give you great hope and great peace.
You know, the other day I heard something that I haven't really been worrying all that much, but I know other people have about, you know, just catching something that and maybe they have some of the risk factors and that kind of thing. And so really worried about catching something and how it's going to impact their body. And somebody quoted this verse the other day and I thought, oh, what a good perspective shift. And it says, but who of you, by being worried, can can add a single hour to his life.
You know, that's Matthew 6, the same portion of scripture that you were reading from before about seeking first the kingdom, of God.
Yeah. And not worrying about tomorrow, for tomorrow will take care of itself. But each day has enough trouble of its own.
Mm-hmm.
You know, here's the thing. Sometimes we can be so future worrying that we lose our peace for today. We destroy our day because we're worrying about what if, what if, what if. And how many times does our what ifs actually come true and happen?
We worry about nothing, literally.
Most of the time, we have caused ourselves huge amounts of turmoil for absolutely no reason. You know, and one of the biggest lessons I learned when I took in the kids with foster care was that I couldn't sit there and go, oh my gosh, what if I love these kids and lose them? What if they go back home? What if this happens? Or, you know, I don't get to know how they come out. Or, you know, and I just went, you know what, Lord, I can't go there. I am just going to trust that you're big enough that if I have to walk down the road of they return home and I have to grieve losing them, that you'll make a way and you'll walk me through that. You're big enough to handle my grief. And so literally, and I put a roadblock up and went, I'm not worrying about that bridge unless I actually have to cross it because I may not.
Yeah.
You know, and so I literally just did that. And every time that thought came up, I went, no, I am not crossing that bridge in my brain before I know I have to cross that bridge. So until they tell me that I'm taking those kids and dropping them off tomorrow morning, I am not worrying about that bridge until I have to cross it. And I literally put a stop and a roadblock in front of it. You know, it just, I knew that the worry that that would awaken or fire up in me would take so much energy and focus that I wouldn't be able to give my best to what needed to happen right now. And I had, you know, I had a little boy who needed safety and he needed to feel loved. And, you know, and I knew I needed to be all present and I didn't need to worry about the rest.
Yeah.
So, you know, I.
That's such a good illustration for really where we're at today and how faith over fear and controlling our thoughts, which is biblical, you know, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of Christ.
Taking every thought
captive. Every thought captive. How important that is. In all of our life, but especially when we are worried about things that have not yet happened. We don't know what will happen.
Yeah.
We do know, however, that it's time for a break here. Mm-hmm. So a break is going to be happening here. And listener, we hope that you come back and join us after this little message for you here in the Circle of Friends.
Looking for ways to change up your holiday decor? Stop and visit the shops at Shia Market. At the Village Gift Barn and Country Gatherings, you'll find accessories to complete your style. Need tips on decorating your tree or table? One of our talented team members will be happy to assist you. We want you to shine bright at Shia Market in Berlin, Ohio. We offer easy access from state routes.
Will run.
Welcome back to the table with Circle of Friends. You found a place to belong with us, and we're so glad you joined us. Missy, I was just thinking on our break about back to what we had been talking about with just recognizing doctrine mistakes or skews, for example, and specifically just kind of the one about being prosperous and life looking great. Because honestly, I think we might end up in a season of suffering. Mm-hmm. And I think it would do us a lot of good because our faith needs to deepen. And those rough times of suffering and affliction are times when your faith deepens and you grow in intimacy of knowing God and you recognize your need for God's word. Mm. And so I was kind of flipping a couple more verses in Philippians. And the interesting thing is, okay, you know that verse in Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through mm-hmm. Christ?
Yes.
Okay, so never recognize the context for that verse.
Yeah, we just pull it out, right?
You ready for this? Okay, because this isn't, life isn't grand here, okay? So if you back up a couple verses, let's go to 10. But I rejoice in the Lord greatly, and now at last you have revived your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned before, but you didn't have an opportunity. Not that I speak from want, for I have learned to be content in whatever circumstances I'm in. Okay, so let me back up and kind of explain here. He's rejoicing because they've had an opportunity to give to him. That's what he means by you've revived your concern for me, is financially they gave a gift. Paul at this point is under house arrest, I believe, and it wasn't free. He had to pay for his housing. And so kind of crazy. They would throw you in a house and then charge you rent, but you weren't allowed to leave.
And for food and all of that.
Right.
Yes.
And so it was ridiculous, but the churches contributed and people were allowed to come visit him and leave freely, but he was not allowed to just go wherever he chose. Anyway. Okay. So listen to what he's saying here. Not that I speak from want, for I have learned to be content in whatever the circumstances I am. I know how to get along with humble means, but I also know how to live in prosperity. In any and every circumstance, I've learned the secret to being filled and going hungry, both of having abundance and suffering need. Now we get to, I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Mm. Meaning I can do abundance and I can do suffering need in Christ. We don't always see that. We make it like, oh, I can do anything in front of me in Christ. And that's not what this is talking about. This is talking about walking through affliction.
Yeah.
Want, need, hunger, like lack. And that's the very antithesis of some of what's being thrown around in the Christian community right now. You know, I will never forget in college, like there were believers that would teach some of these young followers of Christ that if you have enough faith, you won't get plane sick. You won't get car sick. You'll, you know, God will heal you of this and your depression will go away. And sometimes God walks you through those things. Mm-hmm. He doesn't remove them.
Yeah. It's for his purposes. He has a plan. And it's, I mean, read scripture and it will tell you, you know, to endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ, that doesn't sound like...
That doesn't sound like you should be expecting life to be great.
Right. Mm-hmm. You know, in this world, you will have tribulation
right.
or trouble. Jesus himself told us that. But be of good cheer. I have overcome the world.
Yeah.
So the idea that we are going to suffer is very, very clear, both in example and in scripture itself that says, you know, mm-hmm. We will suffer. And we talked about Philippians 3 and the verse that, mentions the fellowship of Christ's suffering.
Yeah.
What does fellowship mean? That's joining in, right?
Yep.
That's taking part. Are you prepared to enter into the fellowship of Christ's suffering? Christ's suffering was beyond our imagination. Who knows what we will have to walk through on this earth?
Yeah.
And we do a great disservice and discredit to our brothers and sisters who are suffering even right now in circumstances we can't even begin to imagine, where their faith is a glowing testimony. You know, you think of people who have been martyred for their faith, or who walk through difficult times because they live in areas where their faith is, you know, they're persecuted for their faith. But what we're talking about, Gwen, is if those hard times come to us, and they will.
They will.
Whether it looks like persecution.
I would agree with that.
100%. Or something else. Hard times will come because Jesus himself told us that it would. Mm. This world that we live in is not perfect. And yeah. As you said earlier this week, you know, creation itself is decaying. Sin yeah. is in this world, and we will see the effects of that sin, both ours and others.
Well, and Missy, I just think if millennials, according to Barnum's study, 2% are actually walking consistent with biblical principles in how they live their life and view the world. Government is eventually going to be run by them. Culture is going to be established by them. It's already shifting.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we went from 20% with a godly worldview and baby boomers to 2%. And how do you look at stats like that and truth like that and just recognize that at some point to follow biblical principles will put us at odds with our culture, with our government, with our world?
Mm-hmm.
It's going to put us at odds, and there's going to start being a cost for that. I mean, we've already seen some examples of that with bakers and, you know, just professions that are paying a price.
Yeah.
You know, and that will only rise. That will only grow. You know, so here's the thing. I just think shine like lights.
Mm.
Live consistent with what you believe. You're not saved by your works, but because you're saved, because of his love with which he loved you.
It makes me think of Colossians 3.
Live different.
Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. You've got to get your perspective right.
Yeah.
Because if you are clinging to the things of this world, then your God is your appetite for whatever it is that you're clinging to here in the world.
You can't take cultural things and move them into your faith so that you are not at odds. You cannot do that without compromising your faith.
Thank you. Because people are doing it every day.
Oh, they're doing it all over the place.
Yeah.
And what you're doing with that is you're choosing that this culture becomes the God of you.
Yeah.
It becomes who you serve, and your walk with God and scripture and Christ, he takes a quieter and smaller place in your life.
Yeah.
Again and again and again, as you choose this concept of the world and this one at the world so that you're not at odds with it, so that you're not in enmity with it. You got to understand, Christ came to set sister against sister, to set us at odds with the world. Because if we're living kingdom principles, we are not going to fit our culture.
You know, I repeat this often, but this is what God's word says, that the world is at enmity with God. That means that the world is God's enemy. If you look at your life and it fits with the world, you're becoming an enemy of God. That's right. Really what you're doing. You have to set yourself at odds, as you said, with the world, because we're to live radically different lives. And if our lives aren't radically different than those that are in the world, we don't have it right.
Yeah.
We got it all wrong at this point.
And I think we need to stop expecting that the other is going to listen to us.
Yeah.
And hear us. We're going to have to expect that they are going to be angry at us, that they're going to attack. We need to get over it. They're not going to play nice anymore.
It makes me think that the fragrance of Christ is it is a stench to those who are dying. I mean, it's beautiful to us who know him and are alive in him, but to those who don't not know him, Christ is very offensive. And because we become our own gods and we want to do our own thing and we want to be our own authority, so to speak, we want to become God, even though we maybe would never say that. We don't want to be under God's authority. That's what the rebellion is.
Exactly.
That's what the rebellion has always been, starting with Satan himself. You know, he wanted authority. He didn't want to be under God's authority. And I think that desire has continued on down through the ages, and you see it in today's world for sure.
Yeah. And you know, here's the mindset we should have. Do nothing from selfishness nor empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourselves. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also for the interests of others. Have this attitude in yourselves, which also was in Christ Jesus, who, though he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as a thing to be grasped or held onto, but emptied himself, taking on the form of a bondservant. He is our example. Mm-hmm. And being made in the likeness of men, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. For this reason also, God highly exalted him and bestowed on him a name which is above every other name. But that is the mindset that we should have in the middle of this. In the middle of recognizing that we are at enmity with the world, we are to love and care for one another. We are to seek peace. We are to respect as much as we can those in leadership. We are to pray for our leadership. No matter who it is, no matter what we think of their character, no matter what we think of policies, we are to pray for our leadership. We're to seek as much as we can to influence our culture for good. We are. But we are to have the mind of Christ. Emptying ourselves, that humility. I think of Micah 6:8. He's shown you, O man, what is good and what the Lord requires of thee. To do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly before your God. We are to be different. And if you don't look any different, it's time to look in the mirror. It's time to get back in God's word, and it's time to do what Psalm 39 says, where you ask God to search out, to search you and to know you and to see if there be any wicked way within me. That you need to start with yourself. If you want to influence others around you, it starts with you, because you are the example. There's so many times in scripture where Paul looks at these believers that he's writing letters to and says, model the example you saw in me. What you saw me do, that's what you do. That's what this looks like. We are lacking people who are examples, who are living examples to be copied. We're lacking them like crazy. We have had spiritual leaders fall like crazy in the last couple of years. My challenge to some of you listeners, do not disqualify yourself. Start asking God how he would use you in the lives of others. Start asking God what one or two things you need to change to grow in your faith. You found a place to belong here in the Circle of Friends.
This program was brought to you through the generous support of donors and listeners like you. To contact Circle of Friends Ministries, you can write to P.O. Box 345, Berlin, Ohio, 44610, or find us on Facebook at circleoffriends.fm. Program archives can be found at thelight959.com.